beginning at verse 31. Then he went down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, and was teaching them on the Sabbaths. And they were astonished at his teaching, for his word was with authority. Now, in the synagogue, there was a man who had a spirit of an unclean demon. And he cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know you, who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be quiet and come out of him." And when the demon had thrown him in their midst, it came out of him and did not hurt him. So they were all amazed and spoke among themselves, saying, "What a word this is! For with authority and power he commands the unclean spirits, and they come out." And the report about him went out into every place in the surrounding region. So let's begin with some basic information. Notice with me at verse 31 that he's in the city of Capernaum. Capernaum is a city on the northwest coastline of the Sea of Galilee. And during the time of the Lord Jesus Christ, it was a prosperous fishing village. It was actually located on the major highway connecting the west with the east. We were there recently. As a matter of fact, we had some pictures I was going to show you just to get an idea of Capernaum, because Capernaum was very prominent in the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. It was the village of Simon Peter and of Andrew, James, as well as John. And the Bible makes it very clear that this became the headquarters of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's recorded in Matthew 4:13 through 16. After he was rejected in Nazareth, he came to the city of Capernaum, and that began to be the center of operations there in the north for a while. So as Jesus is there, notice verse 31, that he's beginning to teach, and he's teaching on the Sabbaths. Now remember with me that teaching is part of the threefold ministry that we've already seen that the Lord Jesus Christ did amongst the people. Remember with me as we looked at Matthew chapter 4, verse 23, that Jesus Christ had a threefold ministry. He was preaching, teaching, and healing. And so as the Lord Jesus Christ is there ministering, he's giving to them the word of God. Now, why would Jesus be teaching in their synagogues on the Sabbaths? And the answer would be very simply, he wanted them to discover who he was. And so as he would be there in their synagogues, as he would be teaching them, it was in order that he might be revealed to them, so that when he gave the word of God, they would see that this is the one who was referred to in the Old Testament. In John chapter 5, verse 39, Jesus said this. He said, "You search the scriptures, for in them you think that you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me." And so he would reveal the scriptures, for in revealing the scripture, he would reveal himself to them, and therefore he'd go to their synagogues, and he would teach, and he would teach out of the Old Testament. You see, when the word of God is rightly taught, when it is divided correctly and presented with authority and anointing, and when it's proclaimed, it actually is used by God to bring people to salvation. The word of God is used by God as the means of salvation, so that when the word is spoken and Jesus is clearly presented, people can see him and come to a saving knowledge of him. And that's why Jesus taught, and that's why Jesus would preach God's word to the people. In John 5, verses 45 through 47, Jesus said this. He said, "Don't think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one who accuses you, even Moses, in whom you trust. Had you believed Moses, you would have believed me, for he wrote of me. But if you do not believe his writings, how shall you believe my words?" So he made it very clear that the word of God, as even Moses had spoken of it, even as the word of God was proclaimed and all, concerning Messiah who was to come, he said, if you'd have believed Moses, you'd know who I was. Now the Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so Jesus would go into the synagogues and he would speak, he would teach, he would communicate, and as he did so, he was drawing people to himself. Now, according to verse 32, they were surprised at this. They were surprised at the way he taught. Notice they were astonished at his teaching, for his word was with authority. When the Lord Jesus Christ spoke, he spoke with an authority that came from above. The response was astonishment. When it says they were astonished, that's a strong word. It means to be struck with amazement. As they listened to Jesus speak, he spoke in a different way than the scribes spoke. Now, the scribes or the legal experts as it related to the law of Moses. And during the time of Jesus Christ, the scribes were held in great esteem. They had high honor in Jewish society because they were the authority on questions of faith and practice in the law of Moses. So they were the ones that the people would look to. They would go to the scribe in order that they might be able to receive insight into the things of God. Now, scribes were not a religious party like the Sadducees and the Pharisees. Rather, they were an office, and they never gave independent judgments. They always quoted rabbinic authorities. They did not have their own authority. They simply quoted those who had gone on before them. Even to this day, when you're in Israel, they will quote their ancient authorities. They do not speak with their own authority. No rabbi to this day will say, "You have heard it said, but I say." They don't do that. What they will do is they'll say, "Well, according to tradition, according to what we have received from our fathers, this is the interpretation of this passage." That's how they do that, even to this day. But that isn't the way it was with the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ didn't refer to the traditions of the fathers. He spoke with a personal and heavenly authority, and it caused them amazement. Now, the reason he would speak with that authority is simply this. It's because the heavenly authority was something he had because he came from heaven and therefore could speak as an eyewitness. When you study the Sermon on the Mount, especially in Matthew chapter 5, there are various times that Jesus speaks, and he says things like, "You have heard it said, but I tell you." And when he did that, it caused astonishment in the hearts of the people because he spoke in that way. He spoke as a heavenly witness with heavenly authority. In John 12, 49 and 50, he said, "I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command what I should say, what I should speak. And I know that his command is everlasting life. Therefore, whatever I speak, just as the Father has told me, so I speak." So the Lord Jesus Christ came and spoke with a heavenly authority, and it astonished the people because he wasn't up there saying, "Well, Rabbi Hillel has said, Rabbi Shammai has said," he said, "I say this unto you." And as he spoke with this authority, the people would listen and were amazed that he spoke with such grace, eloquent strength, and anointing. Now, as this is taking place, notice in verse 33, in the synagogue, there was a man who had a spirit of an unclean demon, and he cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know you, who you are, the Holy One of God." Now, as the Lord Jesus Christ is speaking, he now has the opportunity of demonstrating that he has come to deliver the captives. He has an opportunity now to reveal what the Lord has given to him, what the Father has given for him to do. And what he's about to do is deliver a man who is severely demon-possessed. Remember in Luke chapter 4, remember at verse 18 how he had said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed." So the Lord is right now going to demonstrate once again that authority. Now, as he is teaching, a demon-possessed man makes his presence known. So that gives us insight, at least one thing. Demons go to church. There's this demon-possessed man right in the middle of the synagogue. It causes you to wonder for just a moment about the discernment of the individuals who are leading the services there, that this demon-possessed man could comfortably be there, and it's only because Jesus, the light, is there that the darkness is now exposed. Now, as we look at demons, let me give you a couple things about them. We're not here to study demons. We're here to study the one who sets us free from demons, and yet at the same time, now, the Bible is resplendent with illustrations and instances related to demons and all, and so we're going to speak a little bit about that. Because some people today will say, "Well, there's no such thing as demons. I mean, come on, please. That's a childish kind of thing. It's a story that's been made up just to scare people. Demons and devils and all of that. Come on, please. We're in the 21st century. You know, there's really no such thing as demons and all of that. That's a medieval kind of mentality, and today we know better than that." Well, someone once wrote, "Men don't believe in a devil now as their fathers used to do. They force the door of the broadest creed to let his majesty through. There isn't a print of his cloven foot or a fiery dart from his bow to be found in earth or air today, for the world has voted so. But who is mixing the fatal draft that palsies heart and brain and loads the earth of each passing year with 10,000 slain? Who blights the bloom of the land today with the fiery breath of hell? If the devil isn't and never was, won't somebody rise and tell? Is there a devil? Is there not a devil? Well, the Bible makes it very clear that there is a devil and there also are demons. Now, in verse 33, it speaks of an unclean demon. The word demon there literally speaks of an evil spirit or a messenger and minister of the devil. We know that Satan is a created being. We know that he has limited power. We also know that he has an unknown number of spirits that help him, making his power present everywhere. How many? We do not know. But Revelation chapter 12, verse 4 tells us that with his tail, speaking of Satan, that he drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. The stars of heaven are another way of speaking of the angelic host. And so there are untold multitudes of demons. And as you read Scripture, you'll see that demons do exist, and not only do they exist, but for some reason they desire to possess human beings. Not only do they possess, on occasion, human beings, they even desire to possess animals. It would seem that they have a desire to possess a physical body. Recently, when we were up in Israel, we were in a place called the Gadarenes, where there's an interesting story concerning the man of the Gadarenes, though there were two men there at the Gadarenes, and that's a section there that's on the eastern portion of the Sea of Galilee. And the Bible speaks concerning an instance where the Lord Jesus Christ was there, and this demon-possessed individual came and began to speak to Jesus, and as Jesus was speaking to them, in Luke chapter 8, you can see this in verses 31 and 32, the Bible says that they begged him that he would not command them to go out into the abyss. And a herd of many swine was feeding there on the mountain, and they begged him that he would permit them to enter them, and he permitted them. And so it would seem that demons desire a physical, tangible body, and on occasion actually would inhabit a human being. We see that the Bible teaches that demons oppress man and can also possess persons or men and women. Now, let me briefly say that Christians cannot be demon-possessed. I've had that question before, so I'll say it very briefly. Christians cannot be demon-possessed. Why? Why can't we be demon-possessed? Well, we can't because 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16 says that we are the temple of the Spirit of God, and the Spirit of God dwells within us. We know that light will dispel darkness. So when you have received Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are now the temple of the Spirit. And as the temple of the Spirit, the enemy cannot enter in. He can oppress, which can mean that he can give to you temptations to the flesh and all of that. Sometimes he can bring pressures into your life, but you cannot be possessed. The Bible in 1 John chapter 5, verse 18 says, "He who has been born of God keeps himself, and the wicked one does not touch him." And so you cannot be demon-possessed. You might act like you are sometimes, but you cannot be if you're born again, because the Holy Spirit dwells within you. But if you're not possessed by the Spirit of God, if you will, if you're not inhabited by God's Holy Spirit, then you are open to a demon's influence, and even possibly, depending on circumstances, things that you find yourself involved in, and even to the point of perhaps even inviting invasion, you can be possessed if you're not born again. And there are people that I have seen, and there are people that you have too, perhaps on Discovery Channel kinds of things, where they actually invite demons to invade their body. There are people in certain religions that actually do that. My wife Marie, when she was in Brazil as an exchange student in high school, saw people who were actually invaded with demons who invited that. They desire that and actually invite the invasion. And so that does happen. And so a demon can influence, a demon can actually possess, and the Scripture here makes it very clear that this individual in synagogue was possessed. And what they can do very often is they want to influence their lives. And you'll see this in Scripture. What they will do very often is they will try to destroy. Demons do that because they want to destroy individuals. In Mark chapter 9, there's an interesting story there concerning a man and his son, and how the apostles who had remained behind while Jesus took Peter, James, and John to the Mount Transfiguration, how they had attempted to cast a demon out of a little boy and were unsuccessful in doing so. And the father approached the Lord Jesus Christ and spoke to him. It's recorded in Mark chapter 9, verse 22. And he said to Jesus that often this demon has thrown my son into the fire and the water. And so demons will attempt to destroy the host or the body that they are possessing. You see that quite often. They can inflict illness. You see that in Luke chapter 13. There's a woman that's recorded there in right around verse 11 who had the spirit, a demonic spirit of infirmity, and she was bowed over, and Jesus came and delivered her. So they can affect our body. They can even push a person to suicide and all. Well, this is an individual here in Scripture who is possessed by a demon. And notice verse 33, it describes the demon for us. He's an unclean demon. And that doesn't mean that it doesn't take a bath. The word unclean speaks of impurity. It speaks of vulgarity. It speaks of a foul lifestyle. This individual who is possessed with this unclean demon is a vulgar, foul individual. And there he is, though, in synagogue. And notice with me how it says in verse 33, he cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus?" Now, this demon is using the vocal cords of the person that he has possessed. And so the Scripture says he cried out. Now, when he uses the word cried, it's interesting. That word cried speaks of wonder mixed with fear. That's the way he's responding. It speaks of raising a cry from the depth of the throat. And he asks the question there in verse 34, "What have we to do with you?" Now, it's interesting because that's another way of saying that light has nothing in common with darkness. There's nothing in Jesus that a demon can answer to in terms of character, virtue, and everything else. We have nothing in common. The enemy has nothing in common with Jesus Christ. John 14, verse 30 says, "I will no longer talk much with you. The ruler of this world is coming, and he has nothing in me." There's nothing in me that will respond to anything he can offer. Because when you're walking with the Lord, there's nothing in common, you see. And so when the demon is speaking to Jesus, he is saying, "We have nothing in common. I have nothing to do with you, and you have nothing in common with me. We are the polar opposites." And so he says, "Leave us alone. Leave us alone. I don't want you to have anything." Now notice in verse 34 how he says, "Did you come to destroy us? I know you, who you are, the Holy One of God." When he says, "Did you come to destroy us?" Are you going to lock us up in the dungeon? Are you going to put us into the abyss? The answer to that question is yes, but not at this moment. Yes, you will be dealt with, but not at this moment. But notice also, he says, "I know you. I know who you are." Now that's an interesting and important thing, because the demons do know Jesus Christ. They know exactly who he is. You know, the Bible says that Jesus Christ created the angelic host, and that these demons once belonged to the angelic host before they fell. Jesus is the creator of all angels, and the angels originally were all created good, but because the enemy Satan drew a third of them, they fell. But Jesus is the creator of all things. According to Colossians chapter 3, verse 16, "By him all things were created that are in heaven, that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions, principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him." But I want you to notice that fallen angels know who Jesus is. Here's the important point, though. They may know who he is, but the knowledge of who he is does not save them. Just because they know who he is doesn't automatically mean that they are saved. I think we can illustrate that in the United States. There are many people, if you were to speak to them and say, "Do you know who the Lord Jesus Christ is?" They would say, "Yes, I do. Yeah, I know who Jesus is." They could even tell you some things about him. But it would be like me saying, "Well, yeah, if you said, 'Do you know President Bush?' I'd say, 'Yes, I do.'" But what I'm saying is, as I have intellectual knowledge of him, I know that there is one named President Bush. I'm aware of the reality of that. But if you were to say to me, but do you have a personal acquaintance with him? Do you hang around with him? Do you drink coffee with him? Do you ever go over and have dinner with him? I'd have to say, well, of course not. I know who he is, the way that I know who Billy Graham is. I know who they are. But in reality, I have no personal relationship with him. And there are many people in the United States who have the same answer. I know who you are. They will say that, you know, you take the surveys here in the United States and you'll see that at the minimum, there are about 83% of Americans who will state when asked, do you believe in God? They will say, yes, at the minimum. And that 83% are professing Christians of every stripe. So they will say, oh yeah, I'm a Christian. You know, but in reality, they don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, if 83% of the United States was born again, then who's in jail? Only unbelievers? Who's going to the bars? You know, who's going to the various places and buying the porn and all of that? Who's doing all of that? You know, only unbelievers? No, it's people who would claim that they are believers in God. There are people who would say that they know who Jesus Christ is, and they would definitely say that, but they don't have a relationship with him. These demons knew who Jesus Christ was, but knowledge does not save you. It's faith that saves you, you see. It's not just knowledge of facts, it's the application of that knowledge that transforms a life. It's the drawing in through faith of the Word of God and saying yes to Jesus Christ. Yes, I'm lost. Yes, I need to be saved. Yes, I need to be forgiven. Yes, I need to know you personally, Jesus. It's not just speaking about him. It's acknowledging and knowing him. It's having a relationship with him. And the demons know who he is because Jesus created the angels. And the demons are part of the angelic host in the original creation. And they fell. Can they be saved? No, never. They will never be saved. They will never be transformed from demons back into, angels. That will not happen. But it's interesting to note that they say they know him. Well, the Bible in James chapter 2, verse 19 says, you believe there's one God. That's good. But even demons believe that, and they shudder. You say you believe in God. That's a good thing to believe in God. It's a lot easier to speak to somebody who believes in God than to speak to somebody who doesn't. You know, here in the United States, it's a wonderful thing. I every time I leave the country for a while and then return, I want to just, you know, literally, I want to get on my knees and kiss the ground when I return because I think what a wonderful place we live in. What a wonderful place the United States is. Israel's a beautiful place, and I love going to Israel. Very hard to the gospel. Very hard to the gospel. You turn on the radio in Israel, you're not going to hear, you know, stations like K-Wave or KKLA there. You're not going to hear that. You're not going to be seeing churches filled with people and Bible studies who are Christians. You are seeing a move of the Spirit right now. You know, just 30 years ago, there were very few Christians in the entire nation. Now there are 15 Messianic congregations in Jerusalem alone. There are several Calvary chapels that have been planted from the north to the south. And God is moving, and it's wonderful to see, especially in these last days. But the fact is, when I get home and I climb into my car and I'm driving, I can turn on Christian radio. I have it on satellite. I have it on, you know, FM radio, I can hear it on AM radio, I can turn on the television and I can hear people speak about the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's just a wonderful place to be. But there are a lot of people who will say, well, I know Jesus, but in reality they don't. They don't have a relationship with God. Had you asked me prior to my conversion if I knew Jesus Christ, I would have said, yes, I do, because I was raised in a home that mentioned his name, because I was raised in a church, because I went through the catechism and had received certain rituals and all by and felt very, very sure that I was a Christian. But I had a demon faith. You know, I believed with my head, but I was never converted. I had a knowledge, but I didn't have a conversion. I could say, yes, I believe in God, and I did, but I didn't have a saving faith. And there's a difference between the two. Because when you have a saving faith, your life is transformed. See, I would say I was a Christian, but I was still going out drinking. I said, I'm a Christian, and I was still doing the dope. I was a Christian, but I was still with the girls. I was a Christian, I said, but I was still doing everything I wasn't supposed to do. But if you'd have asked me if I was a Christian, I would have answered in the affirmative. And so this demon is speaking and says, we know who you are. I know you, who you are, the Holy One of God. I know who you are. But that's not a saving knowledge. So Jesus' response recorded in verses 35 through 37 is he rebuked him and he said, be quiet and come out of him. Jesus didn't want testimony from demons because he's not in league with Satan. And so he says, come out of him. Now notice with me in verse 35, it says, when the demon had thrown him in their midst, he came out of him and didn't hurt him. That's what demons do, is they destroy and one last tear. It's one last kick. It's one last destructive act. He wants to harm him one more time. That's what demons do. That's why I'm amazed that people actually reject Christ in order to be serving, even though they don't realize that they're serving the enemy, because all the enemy does is hurt you, and that's exactly what he's doing here. And so he throws them down, but notice it came out of him and didn't hurt him. So they were all amazed and spoke among themselves and said, what a word this is, for with authority and power he commands the unclean spirits and they come out. And so they're amazed at what is taking place here. And the result is that the report in verse 37 of him went out in every place in the surrounding region. People were amazed, and his fame spreads now, because this is somebody who with a word and authority can actually cast demons out of people. And so they say, this one Jesus Christ, you ought to hear what he has to say. Isaiah tells us in Isaiah chapter 42 verses 6 and 7, and this is a portion that speaks of Messiah. Whew. I asked, have we fixed that? And they said, oh yeah, I guess we didn't. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness and will hold your hand. I will keep you and give you as a covenant to the people, as a light to the Gentiles, to open blind eyes, to bring out prisoners from the prison, those who sit in darkness from the prison house. And that's what Messiah does. He sets you free, and that's exactly what Jesus did. Now, continuing into verse 38, now he arose from the synagogue and entered Simon's house. But Simon's wife's mother was sick with a high fever, and they made request of him concerning her. So he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her, and immediately she arose and served them. You know, someone once said, you know how Simon Peter said that he didn't know the Lord. We all know that. We'll get to that portion later on in the Gospel of Luke, how he denied the Lord. And the question was asked, why did Simon Peter deny the Lord? And the answer is because Jesus healed Simon Peter's mother-in-law. But I'm not quite sure whether that's true or not. That's just something I thought I'd say, just to be mean. It is interesting. It is interesting to note something here about Simon Peter. I want you to see this with me because it's something you might not even notice. I want you to see this with me, though. Notice that he was a married man. Simon Peter was a married man. Jesus is ministering to Simon Peter's mother-in-law. Now, some would say, well, he was married at that time when Simon Peter first began to follow Christ. But shortly after Jesus' resurrection, Simon Peter's wife died, and thus he was free to follow the Lord Jesus Christ unencumbered. Part of the reason that is presented is because there are churches, including the Catholic Church, the church I grew up in, that would like to say that it's a holier thing if you are single than if you are married. That's one of the reasons why in the priesthood they are unmarried individuals, because they believe that basically frees you up to ministry, but also seems to indicate that they think that that's a holier place to be. But the scripture doesn't teach that at all. The fact is that Simon Peter was a married man, and Jesus ministered to his mother-in-law. And this took place, he continued to be a married man you know, all the way into 1 Corinthians chapter 9, because in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 5, Paul was writing, and he said, have we not power to lead about a sister, a wife, as well as other apostles, and as the brethren of the Lord, and Cephas, which is the other name for Peter. And 1 Corinthians 9 was written some 25 years later. So Simon Peter was married, and married for a long time. And so he is married there. And beyond that, I want you to notice something else here, because in verse 39, after Jesus has healed her, she had this high fever. Notice verse 39. So he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her, and immediately she arose and served them. Now that may just go right past you, and I hope that it doesn't, because it shows us something. It shows us that she used her restored health to be of use and service to Jesus Christ and other people. We have been saved to serve. We serve God, and we serve one another. Now, I had a lady in this fellowship who left years ago now, but I'll never forget what she said. She said she was going to another church where she doesn't have to serve. But the Bible makes it very clear that we've been saved to serve. If you don't think so, then just mark down Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. Because in Galatians 5, 13, Paul said, you brethren have been called to liberty, only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. See, the body of Christ is made up of givers as well as takers. And a lot of people are simply takers. A lot of people come expecting to receive. I remember a lady who approached me after a Sunday morning service who said to me, this is the first time I've been to this church, and I just want to know what this church has to offer me. And I fair question, but I said to her in response, I said, it's not what this church has to offer you. What do you have to offer this church? Because we're not here to simply receive. We're here to receive in order to give. When you go to Israel, the Jordan River has three tributaries that connect into the single river. And that single river is called the Jordan. It's called the Jordan River because it descends from Mount Hermon in that area there, which is to the north. And Dan is a portion to the north where the tribe of Dan used to be. So the Jordan, or the Jordan, speaks of that which descends from Dan. That's what the word Jordan means. And the Jordan River will descend. It comes down, and it flows south into what is called the Sea of Galilee. In the Sea of Galilee, even as we're looking at Capernaum, it is to this day, and it was at that time a place that was a very large lake that people would look at as a sea because it was so large, and they would fish there, and there were living creatures, of course, in the water because it's healthy, because it's flowing. The water flows from the top there in Dan and enters into the sea, and it's alive. But it continues south. The Jordan River descends and continues going south, and it ends up in a place called the Dead Sea. And it's called the Dead Sea because it has no outlet. See, the Sea of Galilee is a living sea. It has, in other words, living water. You can drink it. And it also has a water that fish can live in and all, because it's a living sea. When Jesus speaks concerning living water, he's simply saying it's water you can drink. It's something that has life. It's able to produce life or give life or sustain life. So the Sea of Galilee has living water. But the Dead Sea is true to its name. Because if you let a cup of water from the Dead Sea evaporate, one-third of that water is mineral. If you drink a cup of it, you can die. If you open your eyes underwater, it will be like hot irons being pressed into your eyes because it is that rich in mineral content. And it's dead because it has no outlet. It's dead because it only receives and doesn't give. And when the Lord grabs hold of your life, when God speaks to you, when God pours his life into yours through the living water, it's not so that you can keep it for yourself. It's so that it may splash out of you on other people. It's so that you might have an influence. And how do you have influence? Part of the way that you have influence is like Peter's mother-in-law. She was sick, she was healed, then she served. Because when the Lord Jesus Christ grabs hold of your life, he transforms you. And from a person who's always saying, what has it got for me? What's in it for me? What profit do I have if I pray? What profit do I have if I read the Bible? What profit is there for me? From that mentality, you are transformed to a person who says, Lord, I've received from you, and now I want to give what you've given to me. I want to give out what you give to me. It's the most unhealthy thing when all we do is take and take and take. And I hear that all the time, by the way, in one form or another. You don't know how hurt I've been. You don't know my life. You know, it's all about me. It's all about everything about me. And that's the problem. Because when it's all about you, well, Jesus said it this way. He said, it is more blessed to what? To give than to receive. Are you kidding me? Most Americans would say, it's a lot more blessed to receive than to give. I want more for me. Now the Lord says, listen, I give to you so that you can give to others. You know, I distribute to you so that you can distribute to others. And by the way, I can distribute to you in abundance so that you can abundantly bless other people. That's why I give to you. Not so that you can hoard it up and keep it to yourself and bury it like a talent in the ground and not use it at all. I give to you so that you can use it. So that you can reach out and you can give to somebody else what I've given to you. I mean, that's why you evangelize. That's why you go out and that's why you talk to your friends. That's why you talk to your family. That's why you share the word with people. That's why you tell them your testimony. That's why you invite them to church. That's why you do what you do. It's because God has done something in your life that is so remarkable, that is so stupendous, that is so amazing, that is so rich and wonderful that you can't help but talk about it. You can't help but talk about the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said it's out of the abundance of the heart that the mouth speaks. And when the Lord is filling you with his goodness and his grace and his love and his mercy and his joy and his peace and so many wonderful things, I mean, how can you but speak of him? How can you help but speak of him? You know, I have people tell me that I talk about my wife a lot. And I didn't realize that. Because it's out of the abundance of the heart that the mouth speaks. I didn't even realize that I'd find a way to speak of my wife in every Bible study I give. Never realized I did that. It's just, that's my life. That's the person that influences me. That's the person I love. So it comes out very easily. It isn't like in my notes, right here at this point, better speak about Marie or she's going to hit you with a pan. It doesn't say that. You know, I just do. I just do because it's easy to. It's easy to talk about the person you love. It's just very easy to do that. Talk about my Josiah, talk about my kids. You know, I talk about my family. Why? Because I love my family, and it just comes out. It's just very natural for me to do that, right? It's that way for you too. It's just that way. What's important to you, speak about. It may be baseball, it may be football, it may be basketball, it may be a car, it may be a relationship. It's going to be something that's important to you, and you'll talk about it very naturally and very easily. You know what happens when the Lord grabs hold of you and really does? You talk about him. People come up and say, well, you know, can you teach me to witness? No, just fall in love with the Lord. When you fall in love with the Lord, you'll talk about him. When you're reading the word, there'll be things that he's teaching you that you're going to want to tell other people about. That's the way it works. But if you want to memorize the four spiritual laws, you can, or the Roman road, you can. It's not difficult to do that. There are ways to do that, and you can use evangelistic tools, and those are wonderful to do. But the bottom line is out of the abundance of the heart that the mouth speaks. And so as you have relationship with the Lord, you will naturally talk about it. It's just that easy, and it comes out very naturally and all of that. And service to Jesus Christ, guys, isn't mandatory. It's not like, oh, you better serve or else you're not a real Christian. Service to the Lord is just the reality. It's just what we do. You know, and like Jesus says, we'll see this later on, how Jesus speaks concerning one who says, I am an unprofitable servant. I've only done that which I am supposed to do. I serve you because I do, because I enjoy it. You know, there's some things that you can't pay me to do. You can't pay me to change baby diapers. No, you can't. But I did. And I did because I love my kids. And they stunk, so you better change them. I did because of love. There are some things that love pushes you to do that money can't push you to do. You just can't pay me enough to do that. But if I'm in love with my babies, which I was and am, what's the big deal? You just take care of business, has to be done. No biggie. It's not hard to do that. It's not difficult, guys. It's very natural when you're in love. And serving the Lord Jesus Christ, it's natural for those who are in love with him. And that's what you're seeing here. Simon Peter's mother-in-law had a fever. The Lord Jesus Christ sees her. And because his ministry of one of deliverance and healing, he heals her. He rebukes the fever. He speaks to it and rebukes it. And what's it do? It says in verse 39, left her. And what's her response? She arose and served them. And that's just the way it is. That's how it works. So in verse 40, now when the sun was setting, all those who had anyone sick with various diseases brought them to him, and he laid his hands on every one of them and healed them. And demons also came out of many, crying out and saying, "You are the Christ, the Son of God." And he, rebuking them, did not allow them to speak, for they knew that he was the Christ. Now, when it was day, he departed and went into a deserted place. And the crowd sought him and came to him and tried to keep him from leaving them. But he said to them, "I must preach the kingdom of God to the other cities also, because for this purpose I have been sent." And he was preaching in the synagogues of Galilee. And so the Sabbath day is now over. People begin to flow out of their houses. It's probable that they waited for the Sabbath to end before they sought him out, because they were afraid of the religious leaders, because the leaders believed that healing on the Sabbath was actually a physical work. We'll see that later on as it's illustrated for us in chapter 13. And now they're there being ministered. Notice how it says they gathered the sick and those in need, and they brought them to Simon and to Andrew's house. And so what is taking place is they're beginning to come to be ministered to. And what is taking place is at Simon and Andrew's house, according to Mark. But they desire Jesus to touch them, and they desire Jesus to set them free. But again, in verse 41, he didn't allow the demons to speak because they knew he was Christ. He didn't need demons to proclaim who he is. He doesn't want to be associating with demons in his ministry. He doesn't want the witness of Satan. There's an interesting story in the book of Acts in chapter 16, I believe, where the Lord used the Apostle Paul to cast out a demon from a woman who was following after them and was saying, these men are anointed by God and bringing, you know, the power of God to you and all. And the Bible tells us that the Apostle Paul got tired of hearing that, because he did that daily, and he turned around and he cast the demon out, because he didn't want demons to be associated with Jesus Christ. Now, one very basic application, and you may not appreciate this application, but it's true. I find it interesting to note that there are many religions that will say that Jesus Christ is Son of God or a prophet. The Muslims will tell you that. They will tell you that Jesus is the last great prophet prior to Muhammad. They will tell you that. You can read writings, and I've done this, writings of Buddhists, and the Buddhists will speak concerning Jesus Christ. And they will say he was a prophet of God and a good man. They associate with him. Muslims do, Buddhists do. There are some religious organizations like Jehovah's Witnesses or Mormons. Mormons like to call themselves the Church of Jesus Christ, Latter-day Saints, because they want to be associated with the name Jesus Christ. They want you to believe them to be Christians, because they think that they are. But unfortunately, they're not, according to biblical definition. They're not born again. They don't have a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. They don't. They have a demon faith, though they don't understand that. And I don't say that lightly. It's true. They don't have a regeneration. They don't have relationship with God. But they associate with the name Jesus Christ. Because when they associate with that name, those who have within themselves a biblical definition of what Christ is and what a Christian is may be deceived into believing that these people are also Christians. When I was first saved, I went into the military 3 months after getting saved. I got saved in December. I was in the Army in March. And I met a guy who was a Christian Scientist. And so I was a brand new Christian. And he was Christian Scientist. And so I told him. I mean, I was 3 months old in the Lord. I didn't know anything other than just some basics. So I told him one day, they're in basic training, I said, you're a Christian Scientist? And he goes, yeah. I said, I'm a Christian too. We're the same? And he looked at me and he says, no, there are differences between us. He knew the differences that I didn't know of. He knew there were differences in belief. He didn't believe in sin. He didn't believe in death. He didn't believe in a lot of things that are biblical. But he is a Christian Scientist. I thought a Christian Scientist was a guy who did chemistry. I mean, I didn't know what a Christian Scientist was. I didn't know their theology. Seriously, I really didn't. I thought they were just into science. I didn't know. And so I discovered these things after getting saved. I started reading their material. I started looking into the faith and belief, and I discovered that they associate themselves with the name Jesus Christ, but didn't know the Lord. Jesus doesn't want to be his ministry to be broadcast by demons. And that's why he says, don't be saying anything. I don't want you broadcasting for me. I don't want association in that way. Now, it says in verse 42, when it was day, he departed, went into a deserted place, and the crowd sought him and came to him and tried to keep him from leaving them. But he said, I must preach the kingdom of God to the other cities also. Now notice, because for this purpose I have been sent. And he was preaching in the synagogues of Galilee. I have come to preach the kingdom of God and am not confined to a single place. You want to keep me from moving on, but I have a higher purpose, and that is to take the message through the nation. Every one of us can be called a salt shaker. Jesus Christ said, you are the salt of the earth. So every one of us can be a salt shaker, if you will. But the salt does no good if it remains in the shaker. I don't know about you. I hope you don't mind this cultural reference here. I hope you don't. I love beans. I do. I mean, I can just eat beans by themselves. I mean, I love them. Sorry. Man, I was gone for 2 weeks. I was dying. No beans. All of Israel, no beans. But I'll tell you something about beans. Everybody knows this. I never eat them without salt. I don't like the taste of beans without salt. They're bland. But you put a right amount of salt, man, you can eat a pound of them. And they're so good. With a little chili. Some meat. And a tortilla. The truth. But without salt, they don't have a taste. Salt, I could have my bowl of beans right in front of me, and I have my salt in a shaker. But if I don't take that shaker and shake the salt out, that salt does me no good. The salt has to get out of the shaker to do its job. How many of us are in shakers today? Just sitting there on the table, ready to be used. But the salt has to come out of the shaker. That's what Jesus Christ intends for you. He didn't stay in one place. He said, I have a purpose. The purpose is to take this message through the land. That's what we're called to do. You come to an evening service or a Sunday morning or whenever it is, not just to get fat with God's word, but you are equipped to serve so that you can take what God gave to you and share it. The salt has to come out of the shaker. It has to be spread out. It gives taste to the world, and it retards the decay. It's white because it's a symbol of purity. And Jesus used that so that we would know that when he says this in Matthew 5, by the way, he said, you are the salt of the earth. He was saying, you are the only salt of the earth. The way he's saying it isn't that you're just a salt. You are the only salt of the earth. And salt has great value because that's where the term he's worth his salt came from, because they would actually pay Roman soldiers with seasonings. And salt was a seasoning of great value, and you'd actually be worth your salt. It's just speaking of the fact that salt had value, because salt has taste that produces something pleasant, you see. And so that's what God has called us to do. Jesus isn't going to stay there. He's not going to remain in one place, even though they're saying, stay here with us. Nope. I've been sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I will go from the north to the south and everywhere in between, bringing this message. I cannot stay in one location. And he could not stay in one place there. And we ought to be like he, in that we take what God has given to us and give it to other people too. So we're here for an evening service to be equipped for works of service, so we can go out and take what we know. And because we're in love with Jesus Christ, we can be used by him to serve God and to serve others. And we have a message that we take to the world that sets the captives free. So even people who go to a church service who are not enlightened, who don't have a relationship with God, can encounter the power of God in that service and be delivered, which occurs every time you open your heart up to Christ. Whenever you open your heart up to Christ, you're delivered. And you're translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's Son. And you are set free from the bondage and power of the enemy. And that's what Jesus Christ intends to do, to take his message and set captives free, and to equip us to do the same. And that's what God has called us to do.